The Redondo Beach Center for Spiritual Living and the Ministry of Dr. Moira Foxe presents Living Ideas.
It's good to see you on this crisp morning. I tell you, you know you're alive today. My kind of weather. Like that a lot. And so here we are all ready. And with that glow, even it is from winter, with that glow, we're open and receptive to whatever it is the Spirit has in store for us today. And as you know, it's always good. It's always very good. And God bless you all for getting up out of your warm beds and being here today. I know, I'm sure the call to stay in pajamas and have hot chocolate and sit by the fire was strong. But here we are, and it's a good thing. And so, as you know, this week we're continuing on in the process of understanding the basic fundamentals of science of mind. And last week we looked at the thing itself, infinite intelligence, the creator of it all, first cause, the absolute, the unmoved mover. And we saw that it was good, and it was very good. Now today we're going to look at the way it works, the way all of that works, how it comes together for us in our lives, and what we can do with that, because knowing something is one thing, and then you have to ask yourself, what do you do with it? You know, they say that knowledge is power, and I say baloney. The application of knowledge is power. Knowledge is just knowledge. You can have knowledge and sit in it and do nothing with it. But applying it, therein is the power. So what we know, what we recognize, we are now identifying with, and identifying with it, we can use it. And so we're looking today at the way that the divine infinite intelligence works. And the way it works is by means of law. There is a law of life. There is a law of being. And you and I are engaged in it. And so you have this thing called spirit, and it's all embracing, and it's everywhere present, and it fills everything. That's what omnipresence means. And it's there available to us. It's just there available to us. It's around us, it's about us, it's above us, it's below us, it's within us, available to us. And the way we work with it is by understanding that it is a law of life, and then we come into cooperation with that law of life. We apply what we know to the lives that we are living, and then because of that, great good things happen, and we can maintain ourselves in that poise, in that peace, always empowered. And so it's like, again, the triune aspect of life. It's not just the triune aspect of a God in this religion or a God in that religion. There's a triune, a threefold part of life, all of life. And you and I are engaged in it. And so as we approach it from the way we understand it in the science of mind is that there is indeed this Trinity and spirit, the first cause, the absolute, is one aspect. And then the way spirit works is the second aspect, which is the law, or what we call soul. Why do we call it soul? Because the soul of everything is out of which everything flows. It is the womb of creation, the soul. The womb of creation, the creative aspect of being. That's what the law is. In Orthodoxy, it's known as the Holy Spirit, the feminine aspect of God. In our tradition, we call it the soul, which is the law, which is the creative medium, which is the action of spirit upon itself. And because of that action, something is created and something comes into being, which takes us into the third aspect of life, which we call the body. And the body for us is the body of creation. All of creation is the body of God. All of creation is the body of God. That is why you can say, I am the Son of God. All of us are the Son of God. The tree is the Son of God. You are the Son of God. I am the Son of God. Everything is the Son of God. Everything is the body of God. So what happens is the action between the spirit and the soul produces the body. The action between the spirit and the soul produces the body, and it's ever been thus. I was taught as a little child that the love between the Father and the Holy Spirit produced the Son. Same thing. Very same thing. Different way of understanding it, different language, but the very same thing. So we're looking at the law today and understanding how the law works. Well, the law works the same way for everything and everyone. It works the same way for originating first cause, spirit itself, as it does for you. Why is that? Because the law is the law of consciousness. It is the law of mind in action. The law has to do with mind, with consciousness, with the power of infinite intelligence, with the intuitive intelligence within you, with the consciousness within you, with the mindset within you. It works upon that the very same way as it does. In the beginning, there was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And then what happened was God contemplated the Word, and the Word came into being. And so you have creation. And the way Spirit creates is the very same way you create. You have an idea, you contemplate the idea, you think the idea, you feel the idea, and the idea comes into your experience as an experience. Very same way. And that's how you are the image and the likeness of your Creator and your Source. You are the image and the likeness of your Creator and your Source in your soul, in your spirit, in your consciousness. That's how you image your Source. Through your spirit, your essence, your consciousness. Now, nobody can see your essence. Nobody can see your spirit. Nobody can see your consciousness. But we sure can get a sense of it by the way you show up in the world, through the way you think, through the way you feel, and through the way you behave yourself. Me too. But we can't see that essence. We can only experience it in the way that you show up. In the way that I show up or anything shows up. I can say, well, according to my experience with him, according to my experience with her, he's a this or she's a that. But I can't describe your essence. I've never seen it. I've never seen the power that grows the plant that I have in my window box. But I sure see its result in the plant that has grown in the window box. And so today we're looking at this thing called this great law that is available to you and to me. What is its characteristics? What are the characteristics of the law? Well, the law of life, the law of mind, the law of consciousness plays no favorites. It has no favorites. It doesn't make any differentiation between anyone or anything. It is totally neutral. It is available always to us. Its power is available to us at all times, in all circumstances and in all situations, regardless of how we're feeling. It's available to us at all times. It says in the scriptures, he neither sends the sun and the rain to rain and shine upon the good and the not so good alike. No favorites. I mean, the divine being doesn't say, okay, they're good today, let them have sun. They've been terribly naughty. They can be cold and miserable or whatever. No, it's all there available to us all. And we're all exposed to it equally. It's neutral. It has no favorites. What else does the law show of itself by way of characteristic? Well, it responds to us immediately. Always, immediately, it responds to us. But you have to understand how it responds to us. The way it responds to us is through corresponding to us. What do I mean by that? Remember, you're consciousness, I am consciousness. And the way we move through life and living is through the way we think. So, the law corresponds to your thinking at all times. The law corresponds to your feeling at all times. The job of the law is to always agree with you and affirm what you're thinking, and it always affirms what you're thinking. It will affirm your negativity and it will affirm your positivity, but it will always be in agreement with you and it will always correspond to whatever is going on within you. Because it understands that if I'm thinking it, it's what I want. If I'm thinking it and if I'm feeling it, it's what I want in my life. So it makes the way straight before you for that to happen in your life and come into your life and to be realized in your life. The law responds to you by corresponding to your thinking and to your feeling. Do we get that? The law responds to me and corresponds with me in all that I'm thinking and feeling. I need to know this so that I can think aright and think intelligently and think in a way that advances me and supports me and think in a way that is an upraising of not only my life, but all life. Because that's how mind in action works. The law of mind in action works that way. And so that is why we're told, take your mind off your problem and put your mind on your good. Take your mind off that sense of isolation, that sense of separation, that sense of aloneness, and put your mind on the presence and the power that fills you always, is around you and about you and ever in you and available to you, regardless of what you're thinking and what you're feeling. The truth is that presence is in you, that presence is available to you, it's everywhere present. Omnipresence, everywhere present. So instead of thinking of separation and isolation and aloneness, think, I am filled, saturated with the presence and the power of life itself. It is available to me and I can use it to take myself out of this sense of lack, whatever the lack is. That's an amazing thing to know. That's a more incredible thing to act upon. And you get to do it, and I get to do it, or not, as the case may be, because the choice is always yours. You are a sovereign being, and you have free will to think and choose as you will. But remember what Ernest Holmes says. Ernest Holmes says, don't think for one moment that an hour's meditation here and there, an hour's prayerfulness here and there, an hour's good deeds here and there will take you out of the troubles and the confusion of life. It will not. Because the law will correspond to the 51% of the thinking that you're thinking all of the time. So it can't just be the odd hour here and the odd hour there when we decide to use our minds aright so that the law can correspond to that and bring that into our lives. You and I have to keep clear-headed all of the time, mindful all of the time. That's why Buddhism pushes mindfulness so much. Stay present, stay mindful, stay focused, know what you're thinking, know what you're feeling. If it's not supporting you, then change it. You see, that's how the law works. It only works through you and can only bring to you what you're available to yourself. It can only take you as far as your own mental reach. It can go no further for you than your own mental reach. And you can only go as far as your mental reach. And sometimes it's this much, and sometimes it's this much. Well, we want to have this much most of the time, at least 51% of the time. That's the majority. So how is your thinking? That's what we're going to be asking ourselves this week. What in heaven's name am I thinking? Because as I'm thinking, there goes my feeling. And when my feeling is combined with my thinking, it's a done deal. I'm going to have that experience in my life. There is no ifs, ands, buts about it. That will show up in my life as an experience. So I jolly well better be thinking good thoughts. I better be feeling good feelings. Otherwise, you know, it's like a craps game out there. We never know what's going to show up. And so the invitation this week is to get into the awareness of yourself as this sovereign being, as this amazing intuitive intelligence that can direct your own life any old which way you choose to direct your own life. But for that to happen, you have to get over the nonsense that you've been telling yourself, and so have I. I mean, think about consciousness, what it is like. Consciousness is very like, if you understand gardening, you get a real good sense of it. There's the gardener, there's the soil, There's the seed. The gardener has knowledge, has awareness. The gardener knows how to prepare the soil and get the soil ready for the best seed that he, she has chosen for it to go into and grow beautifully with the care that a gardener is going to bring to it. Well, what is the garden? What is the garden? The garden is the idea. It's the clear idea that you as a sovereign being thinks, gets in your mind a clear idea. That's the gardener with a clear idea in mind. What is the soil? The soil is the operation of the law within you. The soil, your mind, your subconscious mind is the law. And it is the most fertile soil that you will ever know. Your subconsciousness now, mind you, is that beautiful soil into which you take your seed. And what is the seed? The seed is the thought that you want to realize, the good that you want to realize, the idea that you want to build on and bring into your experience. So you take that thought that you've clarified in your conscious mind and you drop it into your subconscious mind, the fertile soil of your being, and then that thought takes root and you, the gardener, take care of it by nurturing it and nourishing it, by supporting it with affirmation after affirmation, a realization and an awareness of knowing within you that this is going to happen, and you let nothing get in the way of you. You take care of that seed that you've sown by shutting your mouth, zipping your lips, and not telling anybody about it until it's firmly rooted and growing and growing and growing, and it's strong enough to survive the hailstorms and the rainstorms from the friends that will tell you that you're really absolutely deluding yourself and this can't happen and so on. So you have to be aware of that. I mean, I have here within me, or with me, this, and you can't even see it. It's a tiny acorn. And within that tiny acorn, there is an oak tree. You know how strong and how powerful an oak tree is. But you see, me keeping this will never give the oak tree a chance to be realized. This has to go into the soil so that it can take root to grow itself into an oak tree. But see, this was given as a wonderful little gift. And so it stays on a desk to be admired and to be appreciated for what it is. A beautiful, perfect little acorn. But it's never going to reach its potential ever, as long as it stays on a desk and not in the soil that can help it to grow. I don't know how the soil creates that possibility or makes it happen. I don't know what that process is. I only know it is a process. And once it hits the soil, it's going to take root and it's going to one day be a huge oak tree. How many of these acorns do you have? How many of these acorns have you created? How many fabulous ideas have you had and done nothing with? Done nothing. Let them flit in this ear, and out the window. How many? How many of these are sitting on a desk? A metaphorical desk of yours. Not having the possibility of becoming the great thing it could. That's what you ask yourself this week. That's what I ask myself this week. This week is an opportunity for you and for me to really and truly see if I believe this stuff. Oh, we say that we do. We say that we believe it. We read off sometimes charts of what we believe. But do we? I mean, really, do we? Because if we believed it, we would be acting upon it. We would be using it. We would be putting the knowledge that we have to good use. I'm going to ask us this week to at least take one of our acorns, just one. Just one, that's all. Just one out of the pile that I know you have. One, and sow it, tend to it, care for it, and let it grow into what it's supposed to be, what its potential is. An oak tree, An oak tree. I'm knowing you're going to respond to this, and I'm going to respond to it too. We are going to work upon this, what we know to be so this week. And what does that take? It takes what Paul says. Whatever is good, whatever is holy, whole, whatever is of good report. And he goes on and on and on. Think on these things. Think on these things. So I will say in our language, think upon beauty. Think upon peace. Think upon life and light and love and goodness and kindness and compassion and joy and poise. Think on these things. Imbibe them. Let them fill you up with their essence. Let them overcome you. Let them be who you show up as in the world. Think on these things. You can feel them then. Once you think and think and think upon them, you will feel them, feel them, feel them, feel them deeply within you. Remember this. You cannot understand life. You cannot get a sense of life if you don't embrace it. You've got to have your arms wide open and embrace it. You cannot know the sweetness of life if you don't bite into it. And bite into it zestfully so that you can taste its sweetness. It's there for you to do so. You're not a sideliner. You're not somebody that's supposed to sit in the bleachers and watch it all happen. You're supposed to be in there playing the game. You're supposed to be in there, one with the whole process, caught up with the play of it all. Totally focused, totally centered, totally mindful of what's going on. Why? Because you can. It's not going to happen, though, until you stop telling yourself the stories. Oh, all those untrue stories that you have filled your mind with about yourself and about life and living and everybody else, too. They have to stop. It's the truth we want to focus on, not the lie. The truth that sets us free, not the stories, not the lie. It is the truth that will bring us up and fill us and transport us out of the lack and limitation that we feel. Remember, if you work the law is capable of taking you from sickness into health, from taking you out of sorrow into joy, from taking you out of failure into success, from taking you out of isolation and separation into unity and oneness, if you work it the way it can be worked, and it's given to you to do that. Remember, you've got to be able to let go of all of your I cans, for I can, and more than I can, I will, by Jiminy Crickets, by Heaven's Gate, by whatever, Donald Duck and Mickey Mouse, I will, I am, because I can. Are you ready to do that? Yeah. When? And so it is. I can't wait for this week.